Welcome to More Brains, Less Muscle. My name is Philip Amiola. I'm starting a new series of teachings where we'll discuss lessons in life and business. The essence of this series is to share practical insights from my experience and what I have been privileged to observe. And these are real life issues, not something that someone read in a book or gathered from somewhere, okay? You can see it like maybe writing my memoir in bits and pieces, the kind of things I would like to share with my son, okay? Or with a very good friend, the kind of things I'll be sharing here. So it's going to be more like a heart-to-heart talk or a friend-to-friend talk, okay? And I encourage you to pay attention, because our experiences in life many times can be very similar, and we can always get one thing or the other to learn from each other and from one another. Today we'll be discussing what to do when life is wearing you out. If you have ever felt worn out by life, you have lost your zest for life, you just feel overwhelmed and you feel like, is it really worth it? What do you do? This is the point that people get to, and then they begin to slip into depression, and when it goes out of hand, some people commit suicide. Painful, sad, but it happens. Okay? The good news is that doesn't have to happen to you, okay, if you know what to do. There are times that you just feel like, oh, just get me out of here. If it's possible to just, okay, I was even discussing with a friend recently, and I was saying sometimes I feel like, okay, if it's possible to just reboot life the same way we reboot laptop, okay, and it just looks like we are starting afresh all over again. But we know that as nice as that may sound and as philosophically possible as it may be, it is not very practical. Okay, you cannot reboot life, for example, and just wish that, okay, you were a child again, you are not yet married, you don't have children yet, when all of those things are actually facts in the real sense of it. You cannot just start over. It's good to think of starting over, we say that a lot, but practically the implications are not as palatable as they sound, or as the idea itself sounds. So what do you do when you're in that kind of situation, when you just feel down, you don't even have the energy to do anything, and you feel like life is not worthwhile? Okay, the first thing I'm going to encourage you with is to tell you to never ever give up. Okay, don't lose hope. It is when people lose hope that they lose their zest for life, and then they choose to end it all. So as long as you don't lose hope, there is light at the end of the tunnel. This is not motivational talk, it is practical truth, okay? And I'm going to share some insights on how to go about it with practical examples that you can relate to, especially if you are in business. But this is not just for people in business, it's for everyone. Everyone can learn a thing or two that they can apply to their lives and in their special situations or their peculiar circumstances. The first thing that you should do when you are in that kind of condition is to control your thoughts with your words. Your state is very important, the state of your mind, how you feel about yourself, and a key part of that is your thoughts, the thoughts that are running through your mind, the thoughts that are running on your inside. But the interesting thing is that you can control your thoughts with your words. The Bible says in Proverbs 18 verse 21 that the power of life and death is in the tongue. You know, the issue with this is that many people feel like things have to be difficult. But the truth is that most of the things that will change your life are not difficult. They may not be easy, but they are not difficult, they are not impossible, they are not complex. Okay, so something as simple as speaking the right words can literally transform your life. The entire world is sustained or even suspended is a better word. It is suspended on the word of God. So by the time you start declaring God's words out of your lips, out of your mouth, you are releasing power. And the words that you speak to yourself are more powerful than the words that anybody speaks over you, or the words that you hear others speak to you, and all of that. Okay, so the first thing you should start doing is to start speaking to yourself. Start speaking what you know that God has said, because God's word is constant. You are not just speaking any kind of thing. You are not just saying any words that come to you. You are speaking the words that have been stored on your inside. For example, you can say things like, I know the thoughts that God has towards me. They are thoughts of good and not of evil, to give me an expected end. You are not going to feel like it, but keep saying it, okay? Keep saying it. My path is as that of the just, that shines brighter and brighter unto the perfect day. I am going upward and forward only. You keep declaring these things to yourself, and you are walking up and down, because it's important that you don't resign to faith, as it were, okay? Put your words to work, and as you are doing that, match it up with physical action. Okay, you can walk up and down in your room. You know, don't just sit down and be wishing yourself dead and be wishing your life was not, you know, you are wishing you were in somebody else's shoes, or you were wishing you had it better. That is not going to change anything. Start by speaking and taking charge of your thoughts. You control your thoughts with words. Start by speaking the right words. If you need a guide to help you get started, you can get my book, Order Your Life. You can get the video book free of charge by visiting plenipotent.com.ng/order-your-life. There is an hyphen between order and your, and then your and life, order hyphen your hyphen life. You can see it on the screen if you are listening to this via video, but for the benefit of those that will be listening to the audio, you go to plenipotent.com.ng/other-your-life. Okay, you can get the video book for free, and you can also download the book in multiple formats. You can download it in a lot of other formats, and that will help you to get started with speaking the right words. It is simple, like I said, but it works. It's practical. I have done this. Lots of people have done it. And even science has proven it, okay, that our words affect how our brain works, okay? So this is very, very important. That is your first step. Bombard yourself with words. Keep speaking those words over and over again, over and over again, over and over again, over and over again, okay? Declare them to yourself. Declare them in prayer. Meditate on them. Look at the scriptures that affirm what you are saying, and think about them. The light will break forth in you. You will begin to get understanding. You will begin to get insights on how to get out of that situation. So what do you do next after you have started declaring God's word to yourself? The next thing is to stop dreaming and start moving. The Bible says in Ecclesiastes chapter 5 verse 7 that just as many dreams bring futility, so do many words. Okay, you keep telling everybody what you want to do. Oh, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that, I want to do this, I want to do that. Start doing it. Okay, start taking action no matter how small. Keep moving, keep doing something. Stop talking about what you are going to do. The declarations that you were making earlier, the words that you are speaking to yourself, those words are meant to propel you to action. You are not speaking for the sake of speaking. You are speaking to yourself to change the situations and circumstances, to change your thoughts, okay? Because when you change on the inside, you are going to be able to change your circumstances on the outside. Then as you do that, start moving. Stop dreaming. Too much dreaming will just lead to futility, okay? So stop talking about what you want to do and start doing it. So where are you now? For example, maybe you are in debt and you are feeling like, hey, how am I going to pay this money, this, and then you are overwhelmed by that. Okay, start thinking, what can I do about this? Do I need to get an extra job? Do I need to create some products? Do I need to exchange my services for money somewhere else? Like, there are ideas, there are things that you can do. Do I need a new business idea? Okay, there are solutions. Do I need to cut down my expenses in some areas? So think through and start moving, start taking action. Okay, so whatever the situation is, there is something that you can do. There is a first step that you can take. So find that first step and start moving. Stop dreaming and stop talking about what you are going to do and actually start to do it. That in itself will create momentum and you will start to lift yourself out of that situation of feeling overwhelmed and losing your zest for life. I like the way Goethe puts it. He said, whatever you can do or dream you can, begin it. Boldness has genius, power, and magic in it. The third thing you should do when you find yourself in that kind of situation is to shift your circles of influence. Again, we're going to be looking at Proverbs. In verse 17 of chapter 27, we read that just as iron sharpens iron, friends sharpen the minds of each other. So you influence your friends and your friends influence you. Look at your life and ask yourself, who are the people influencing me? Who are the people I am influencing? And it's not just about friends, your mentors, your relationships around you. Okay, look at the people in your life, especially the ones that you relate with more often day to day, your colleagues at work, your members of your family, people around you. Look at those kind of people and ask yourself, am I a positive influence to these people and are they a positive influence on me? Okay, and that will help you to decide what to do. There are people that you speak with them for 5 minutes and you just feel very depleted. Have you experienced that before? I definitely have. You feel very depleted. You just feel like energy is being sucked out of you. Those kind of people, deliberately reduce contact with them. See, this is very, very practical. These are things that you have to do. You cannot be too nice and then you are wasting your life away because you don't want to offend people. There are times when I'll be around, okay, I have an home office, so many times I work from my home office. Now, someone might want to pay me a visit during work hours without booking an appointment, and then okay, you are knocking. I'm around. I'm not going to say I'm not around. I'm around, but I'm not seeing anybody. That's it, okay? Because you are going to suck out, you know, energy from me. You are not going to help me at that point in time, because this is work hours. The fact that I'm working from my home office does not mean that you can barge in anytime and then interrupt my work. Now, that might sound harsh or hard, but you have to guard your energy. You have to watch your circles of influence. You have to watch the kind of people that are entering your domain. You understand, okay? Because if you keep admitting people that are depleting your energy, you are going to lose your zest for life. You are going to feel overwhelmed. You won't have the energy to go on. So as you are doing that, you need to also identify the people that inspire you, people that make you excited. I have a friend that every time we talk, we always have, even if we don't have an agenda, we always have something to pick. We always have something to learn from each other, and we're always encouraged. Okay, he still called me last night. He knows himself. If he's listening to this night, he will know that he's the one I'm talking about. Now, he called me last night around past 11. I was like, what is happening to this young man? Because it was already very late. Normally, I don't pick my calls after 9, but I was still working, and then past 11, so I said, okay, fine, is this my friend? Let me see what he has to say. And we ended up speaking for several minutes, and it was worthwhile for both of us. So I felt energized after the phone call. So you need to recognize that people are not the same. There are people that energize you. There are people that get you deflated. Relate more with the people that energize you and deliberately reduce your contacts with the people that get you deflated. Relate more with people that sharpen your intellect, sharpen your capacities, and less with the people that make you dull, that, you know, give your hacks a dull edge, as it were. Okay, so that is very important, and these things are very practical. When you find yourself in that kind of situation, okay, these are the things that you should do. We have this injunction in 1 Corinthians 15:33. The Bible is admonishing us not to fool ourselves. Don't fool yourselves. Bad friends will destroy you. Some versions say that evil communication corrupts good manners. Okay, so the kind of people you relate with affects what happens to you. I believe we all know that, okay? So your association will determine how far you can go. It's just like, imagine mixing cold water and hot water. Okay, the cold water will become at least warm, and then the hot water will become warm also. So the temperature of each of them will change. That is the way it is when we relate with people. If you are hot and you are relating with somebody cold, okay, the person will become a bit hot, and then you become a bit cold, and then you find your level, as it were. Okay, so if you want to get hot, you relate with those that are hot. I'm speaking figuratively now. So if you are feeling overwhelmed with life, you are feeling like you've lost your zest for life, then find friends that are upbeat, friends that are doing well, friends that are enjoying their lives, okay, and relate more with them, those kind of people. You are not going to feel like it, but that is another thing that is important. You don't do what you feel like doing, you do what you need to do, okay? So you have to determine to do what you need to do and not just what you feel like doing. The next idea that will help you is to take the focus off yourself. The more you keep focusing on yourself and keep thinking of what is wrong, the more you will remain and the longer you will remain in that situation. Yes, it's bad, it's not, things are not working and all of that, but the longer you focus on that, the longer you dwell on that, then the longer you are going to remain in that situation, because the things that we focus on expand. Whatever you think about, whatever you focus your attention on, it expands. So take the focus off yourself, look up to God and lift up others. Looking up to God is to gain strength, to gain energy, to lift yourself out of where you are, because until you are lifted out, you cannot lift others, okay? So look up to God in prayer, in supplication, in meditation, and in praises also, yes. Praise God in spite of how you are feeling, okay? There is this scripture in Habakkuk that says that though the fig tree does not blossom, though there is no fruit in the vine, yet I will rejoice. I will rejoice in my God. And that's the difference between joy and happiness. Happiness is because of the circumstances, because things are working and all of that. But joy is a fruit of the spirit. It flows from within. It's something that you decide, okay? And then by the help of the Holy Spirit, it flows from your inside. It's not dependent on the situation. It's not about whether things are working or whether things are not working. That's why Paul was, you know, admonishing the church, and he said, rejoice evermore. Okay, rejoice evermore. This is somebody that was in prison telling others to rejoice, and he himself was, you know, rejoicing. So your joy is very, very important. You have to make sure that the situation does not steal your joy, because it is with joy that you are going to draw water from the well of salvation. So it is with joy that you are going to get out of that situation that you are in. And the Bible also says that in the presence of God there is fullness of joy. So when you are in the presence of God, you have joy. That also goes to say that when you have joy, joy is conducive to God's presence. You can enjoy God's presence when you are joyful. And when you are not joyful, when you are gloomy, when you feel like there is nothing to your life and you are just discouraged and disappointed, then you are making room for the devil. You are not going to allow God to intervene in your situation. So ensure that you are joyful. You can change your state. You can sing songs. You can listen to, you know, songs. You can just praise God and make sure you just take the focus off yourself, then look up to God for strength. In Psalm 121, 1-2, the psalmist was saying, I will lift up my eyes to the hills. From whence comes my help? My help comes from the Lord who made heaven and earth. So that is the first thing. And once you have done that, then begin to look around you and look for people that you can help. No matter how bad your situation is, there's still something that you have to give. It could be a word of encouragement. It could be using your skill to help someone. It could be many things. Now, you may be wondering that what's the relevance of Galatians 6 verse 8. If you are looking at the screen, if you are taking this via video, you may be wondering, because that scripture talks about sowing to the flesh and reaping corruption, okay, and then sowing to the spirit and reaping life. Okay, now the relevance here is that Sowing to the flesh is pleasing yourself. You do what you feel like doing. Because you are not happy, you decide, I'm not going to church. You know, I'm using that as an example. Or you decide that, okay, you just loaf around at work. Instead of doing what you want to do, you are checking Facebook and Instagram because you are not happy. Okay? So you are pleasing yourself. You are doing what feels good. Okay? Instead of what is right. So you shouldn't do that. When you do what feels good, instead of doing what is right, you are sowing to the flesh and you are going to reap destruction. You are going to, things are going to keep getting bad. Things are going to keep getting worse. But when you look into your spirit and you do what is right, regardless of the situation, then the life of God is going to have the capacity. You are going to have the capacity to let the life of God transform your situation. So you have to act like what you want to happen. You have to act as if it has already happened, as if it is already happening, regardless of your feelings. And then stop complaining about everything that is wrong and look for other people that you can help. Okay, for example, I was in that kind of situation recently, and okay, I was not happy. There were a lot of things that seemed like they were not working, and even the things that were not working as they should. Okay, fine. One of the things I started to do was I started a free training program. Okay, my trainees are usually paid. Do I have some free trainees too? But most of the time, my free trainees are online. But I started a free face-to-face training where I taught things that, you know, skills that ordinarily people would pay a lot of money to learn. Okay, and one of the people that participated in that training just completed his website today, his first website. He built a very beautiful website on his own, you know, from what he learned in that training. Okay, now that is an example. There is something I can give, and then I decide I am going to give it. Okay, so I rise out or rise up of my own circumstances and look at how I can help others in their own circumstances. So that is just one example. So you can also look at it, okay, is there something that you can do for someone? Is there a place where you can volunteer? Okay, you have to look at that. Don't say that, okay, I don't feel like it, or I don't have what to give. You always have something to give. Okay, and it could even be physical gifts, it could be money, you could give alms, but look for others around you to lift and look for opportunities to improve the circumstances of other people instead of just focusing on yourself. It may interest you to know that as important as you are not really as important as you think. Okay, nobody's as important that if they leave the face of the earth today, that okay, the world will stop running. It's not going to happen. Okay, so if you check out today, the world goes on. People will cry, your loved ones will, you know, mourn for a while. When my dad died, it was as if life was not going to continue. I had, you know, I used to tell my wife that nothing would make me cry, especially death. Like somebody dies and then I'm crying, there's nothing I can do about it, so why should I cry? That was what I used to tell my wife. But when my dad died, I cried like a baby. You know, it was, I was soaked in tears and all of that, and it was as if like, what is happening here and all of that. But life goes on. Okay, so that is the reality. We have to, you know, face reality. We have to live life the way it is, not the way we want it to be. So the way it is that when you are feeling down, when you are feeling like, you know, you are in a bad state, you are in a bad condition, you are not happy with yourself, it is not okay, it is not helpful for you to focus on that. What you should rather do is, okay, look up to God for strength, look up to God for help, then look around for other people that you can help. Don't please yourself, rather seek to please God and then help other people. Okay, that is how to get out of that situation. Then you should audit your activities and commitments. Audit your activities and commitments. Before I go on with this, I just want to add that whatever it is that you are doing for others is like a seed. Okay, and you know, the principles of life are constant. It's just the application in different contexts that varies. It's like a seed. So when you sow a seed, you reap a bountiful harvest. And what we are reaping is not the same, it's not in the same way. the shape is different, everything about it is different. For example, if you sow an orange seed, you are not going to reap an orange seed, you will reap an entire orange. You will reap an entire orange. You cannot eat an orange seed and be happy. It's not going to, except maybe you're using it for medicinal purpose, I don't know, but it's not something that you eat and enjoy. But when you sow that orange seed and then you know, harvest the fruit, you know, you can eat that and enjoy it. It's the same way. What you are giving to others will eventually come back to you in much more valuable form, in a very different form that is much more valuable than what you have given out. It may even be very, very different. You might give out money, for example, and then you get an opportunity, you don't get money back, okay, because sometimes we make that error too of, okay, if I give this 1,000 naira, I'm going to get 100,000 naira. It's not always like that, but it's going to come back to you in many forms and in multiple folds. You need to be aware of that and consciously put that law to work for yourself. So whatever you are doing for others is a seed and it will come back to you. And if you don't sow, then you have nothing to harvest. Okay, so you can't blame anybody for that. Okay, so it is important that you start sowing as early as you can, start helping other people, start investing in other people's lives, start doing things that will benefit others without regardless of what is happening to you or happening in your life. Okay, I think we've said enough on that. Okay, audit your activities and commitments. There are some activities that make you sad, there are some activities that make you happy, there are some activities that make you feel used and useless, and there are some activities that make you feel productive and energized. Recognize those activities and treat them accordingly. Do more of the things that make you happy, the things that you are productive, the things that have long-term results. Don't just do stuff because you feel you should do it. Okay, weigh the consequences, look at the returns. If the return on investment is not worth it, then cut it off. Okay, you need to know the things that you need to delegate, the ones that you need to defer without any serious consequence, the ones that you need to discard, and the ones that you need to do. So categorize your activities and commitments into those four. Okay, you can use 4 D's to remember. So some are to be delegated, let others do them. You can outsource, you can pay for it. If you're in a team and you have team members that are, you know, able to do it, you can, you know, let them handle that. So there are things that you delegate, there are things that you defer, they are not important and they are not crucial in any way, and you can do them whenever you feel like. Okay, defer them until a time that you have more than enough space, more than enough time, more than enough energy, more than enough resources to handle them. Then there are things that you discard. You just find that, okay, these ones are not adding any value to me. I'm just doing them maybe for cultural reasons or for some other purposes, but they are practically not useful for me. They are not relevant for me. And as much as I might want to make other people happy, I need to also be mindful of my own happiness, because if I am not okay, if I am not feeling good, if I am not in top condition, then I cannot help anyone. Then you have to also identify the things that you absolutely have to do. Okay, this kind of teaching, for example, now is not something that someone can do for me, because I'm teaching from my experiences, so I know that I cannot delegate this. Maybe I might be able to defer it, okay, but I cannot delegate it. It's something that I have to do. Okay, if you have a job, your job is something that you have to do. If you have a business, you also have a job. Your business is your job, so it's something you have to do. Okay, there are parts of it that you need to delegate, there are parts that you may need to defer, but recognize the ones that you need to do and the ones that you need to discard. Much more importantly, too, it's important to recognize them and discard them. In Ecclesiastes 10:15, we read that only someone too stupid to find his way home would wear himself out with work. Now, that is not to suggest that we shouldn't work. What it is suggesting is that when you work so much that work is wearing you out, it is because you are doing the wrong kind of work. The right kind of work will energize you. You feel energized, you feel, even if you are physically tired, maybe because you are hungry or something, you don't feel depleted, you don't lose your zest for life when you are doing the right kind of work. So if you are the kind of work, you have the kind of work that always leaves you depleted, that always leaves you feeling like, what kind of life am I living? What am I doing with my life. If you have that kind of life, then you should check it. You should check it. If you, what kind of work are you doing? Okay, find the kind of work that will energize you and cut out the things that deplete you or deplete your energy. Like I said, these are practical things that I have learned, so I'm going to be sharing some examples with you. If I don't know anything about myself, I know that I enjoy teaching and writing, and I do those two well, especially teaching. If you wake me up and you ask me to teach something that I know, I will teach it in such a way that you will feel like maybe someone opened your brain and poured the knowledge in. That is a gift that I have recognized. It's a gift that I have recognized and that I am working to develop. Okay, that it's something that God gave to me and that I'm working to refine and develop. So because of that, sometimes I take it too far. And looking back now, I remember that back then my parents had a school. I was teaching in the school, and I remember that my mom would come and call me that, Shola Kilode, like, okay, Shola is my middle name. Shola, what is happening? See, this is enough. At least rest, because even during break time, I won't give them, I will hit into their break time because, you know, I'm teaching and, you know, like that. And it has continued into adult life. I realized that, I had a coaching program where I teach people how to build digital skills, business, and then we have an apprenticeship program in the company, and I would throw myself into it and throw myself into it. Then I realized that there are some particular people that they are always asking questions, they are always taking my time. Sometimes we'll get on calls, we get on coaching calls for over 1 hour, and after everything, after like 3 months, 6 months, no difference, no change, no results to show. And it's not like they are even paying, it's 100% free. You know, these people are, that I'm talking about in particular, are getting everything free, what others are paying for, and then no results. So I have to tell myself, no, this kind of activity is not productive. Whereas there's somebody else that, okay, he paid in full for everything, and then his results are inspiring, his results are amazing, he has implemented everything, and, you know, it's just very, very encouraging. We speak almost every day. He's a medical doctor, very busy, and he still has time to implement those lessons. And, you know, that kind of person, I know that I should invest more time with him. I still worked on a project with him today. Okay, so that kind of person, I know I should invest more time. So I'm auditing my activities and commitments. I should be more committed to that kind of person that, okay, I see the results and I'm happy, and then, okay, we can even make money together and all of that. Okay, and that is important too, because you need money. I always say, you might have heard me say before, that whoever acts as if money is not important is either deliberately dishonest or sincerely ignorant. So money is important. So if you are investing your energy somewhere, you have lots of activities, lots of commitments, and nothing to show for it, you don't have money, you cannot even pay your rent, you cannot meet some basic needs, watch it. There are some activities and commitments you are involved with that you need to cut out. There are even some relationships that you need to reduce your commitment to those relationships. You don't hate them, you don't dislike them, but you just know that investing in this relationship is not going to help my life. Okay, and you have to, you know, do what is right for you and do what is good for you. You can't be emotional about your destiny. You can't be emotional about your own well-being. Okay, so emotional about it that, okay, you are hurting yourself to please others. It's simply not wise. Okay, so look at your activities, look at your commitments, see the ones that you need to cut out, see the ones that you need to devote more energy too. And I'm going to advise that some of the things that you should consider committing to are activities, group activities where you can tap into the energies of others. Okay, for me, for example, JCI is one of those, JCI business meeting is one of those kind of activities. Okay, if you are a young person under the age of 40 and you have never attended a JCI business meeting, you can, you may want to consider looking for one close to you. If you are in Ibadan, I would advise you, or I would invite you. Okay, don't, it's not a piece of advice now. Let me extend an invitation instead. Okay, I will invite you to join us at JCI Ibadan Elite. There are lots of chapters in Ibadan, but I am part of JCI Ibadan Elite, and it's a wonderful place to be. You can come and see things for yourself. We meet at Carlton Gate Hotel. Carlton Gate Hotel, Idiakpe. There are lots of Carlton Gate hotels in Ibadan. At least I know of three. The one that I'm talking about, where we meet, is in Idiakpe, close to Iwo Road. Okay, Carlton Gate Hotel, Idiakpe. We meet by 2 p.m. every third Sunday of the month. Every third Sunday of the month. That is an activity that I have found that energizes me. Okay, we have training. Somebody comes to train us. We have members that will take knowledge sharing sessions or knowledge transfer sessions. Then we have an older member of JCI that will come to share experience and life stories, and all of those things energize me. And we have refreshments too. Okay, so we have refreshments, we take pictures, it's a nice time. Okay, it energizes me. So that kind of activity, I am committed to it. Then church. Sometimes you may feel as if church is not useful. The truth is, church is like you are recharging your spirit. If you have a rechargeable torch or a rechargeable lamp, and then you keep using it, or even your phone, you keep using your phone and you are not charging it, it will get depleted. That is the way life is also. So you need to plug into a faith community. Okay, for me that is church, for you it may be something else, but you need a faith community to plug into. And that is one of the first things that struck me about JCI. Even though it's a secular organization, the creed is powerful. The very first, you know, part of the creed talks about believing that faith in God gives meaning and purpose to human life. Faith in God gives meaning and purpose to human life. So that's the first line of the JCI Creed. So that's what we believe. Okay, so even though it's a secular organization, it's a place where the values, the activities, and you know, all of the things that are happening, the projects that we're working on, especially the business meeting. Fine, we have social activities too. I have not been part of many of the social activities, so I might not be able to say much about them yet. And I personally now, because okay, I'm an introvert, so social activities tend to drain my energy. But there are people that get energized by that. Okay, so you need to know yourself and know what works for you. So, but I'm just saying that that is one of the circles that I plug into to get recharged. And then church is also very important to me. Okay, so you need to find yours too, where you get plugged in and recharged. And you know, there are sometimes that you have something that is draining your phone's battery, maybe an app that is misbehaving and all of that. You uninstall that app, you remove that app from your phone. It's the same way with your life too. So when you have relationships, activities, commitments that are draining your energy, remove them from your life. Because if what you are doing, if your activities and commitments are wearing you out, then you are not wise. I didn't say that. Okay, it's in the Bible. Only someone too stupid to find his way home would wear himself out with work. And it's not an insult. I'm not being insultive. I have been in that position too, where I have to tell myself, guy, you are not wise. So your activities should energize you. They shouldn't wear you out. When they are wearing you out, something is wrong. Watch them and then audit them. Audit those activities and commitments and separate the helpful from the ones that are not helpful. If you don't remember anything at all, remember that when you are feeling overwhelmed, when you are feeling depressed, when you are feeling disappointed with yourself, when you are feeling as if you are not able to go on, remember that you can harness the power of your words to change your thoughts, to change your state. You can keep declaring the word of God to yourself. You can keep saying the things that God has told you, and you keep repeating those things to yourself, whether you believe them or not. It doesn't matter that you don't believe them, because we know that the word of God is truth. So when you are saying it at first, it will not sound like it. It will not look like it. But as you begin to say it, you start to believe it. And as you now start to believe it, you start to become what you believe. You understand, okay? So if you keep saying that, okay, I have good success, Okay, you keep saying that my path is as that of the just that shines brighter and brighter unto the perfect day. You keep saying that the Lord is my light and salvation. Who shall I fear, of whom shall I be afraid? You keep saying those things. As you keep saying them over and over and over to yourself, you are saying them over and over to yourself, you begin to believe them, and then that faith will rise up on your inside to change the situation. You are going to release God's power to change your situation. So understand that. Stop speaking the words that will bring you down. Stop talking about what is wrong and start declaring what is right. Yes. Stop talking about what the situation is and start talking about what you want to see. Okay. So as you are saying it, you are drawing it to yourself. Okay. Now, once you have done that, you should also look at the things you are looking to achieve and start looking at the steps that you can take towards them. Instead of talking about those things, instead of daydreaming, start taking practical steps towards them. Then the third step is to change your environment and associations. That does not necessarily mean that you should relocate from where you are, but it means that you should find places. I talked about church, for example. Now go for church meetings. So at that point in time, you are changing your environment. You are leaving a place where you are feeling depressed to a place where you can be energized. Okay, go for, you know, association meetings. Maybe you belong to an association like JCI, maybe you belong to Rotary Club, maybe you belong to Full Gospel Businessmen's Fellowship. Okay, look for associations that will help your life. And by associations, I'm not talking about associations in that sense alone. I'm also talking about relationships with people, the kind of people you associate with. Okay, so look at the people in your life presently, your sphere of influence, and then look at the people that will take you, the people and the environment that will take you where you want to be, and associate with those people, associate with those kind of environments. Then take the focus off yourself. You are not the center of the universe. And the more you keep focusing on yourself, the more you keep focusing on your situation, the more you keep focusing on how things are not right, the longer you are going to stay there. So look up to God for strength. Look up to God for help and encouragement. Go into God's word, meditate, search the scriptures, pray, and then get strength and start helping other people. Before you feel like it, even when you feel like you are still down, you know, Paul was saying that, okay, we're pressed but not crushed, persecuted but not abandoned, struck down but not destroyed. Okay, I think Women of Faith also sang it, you know, they put it in songs, but it's actually Paul that, you know, said it in the Bible. And then he was saying that even though we are poor, we are making others rich. Can you imagine that? Okay, we are distressed, but we are helping out others. So that is the principle. So take the focus off yourself. If you don't do this, you begin to engage in unproductive activities. You begin to engage in self-sabotaging habits. For example, some people will start drinking. Okay, you start drinking, and you were not drinking before. Now you start drinking because you are feeling depressed, because you are feeling that your life is, you know, going haywire and all of that. Or you start engaging in some other habits that, you know, we may not want to talk about. Okay, so you should take the focus off yourself and look up to God, then look around you for people that you can help, people that you can contribute positively to their lives. See how you can improve your environment, improve the world around you, make it better than it is now, okay, with the investment of your personality. Then audit your activities and commitments. Look at the things that you are doing. What does your average day look like? What does your week look like? What are the activities that are productive for you? And if you don't keep a journal, or you don't at least have a to-do list that you check every day and then you tick off and all of that, if you don't track these things, that's what I'm saying, you are not going to know the activities that help you, the commitments that deplete you and all of that. So it's important that you start tracking these things. Okay, so for example, every day I list, these are the things I want to do. Then at the end of the day, I look, okay, which ones did I do? Okay, so what are the results from each of them? So it shows me the things that I need to reduce, the things that I need to do less of, and the things that I need to do more of. And sometimes, let me give this caution here, sometimes there is that tendency of cutting out activities that are actually productive. So that's, I'm going to give you the principle that Jesus gave in one of his parables, where a farmer planted good crops. The farmer planted wheat, and then weeds started growing among the weeds. So the people working with the farmer came to the farmer and said, oh, let us uproot these weeds. No, the farmer said, no, don't worry, leave them, because if you uproot those weeds now, you are going to uproot the crops with them too. So let them grow together for a while, then later we're going to uproot them during the harvest. So sometimes before you drop an activity, before you drop a commitment, try to see how well you can manage it, okay, together, then check the results. You understand? Check the results. Don't be too hasty about it. That's what I'm saying. Don't be too hasty because, okay, no, I just want to be fragile, and then you just drop everything. No. Try to see the results. Try to give yourself some time and check empirically. Have facts, have results to base your decisions on. Okay, so but once you have done that, any activity that is not productive or that is not worth your investment, cut it off, even if it doesn't feel good. There are lots of people that I would like to connect with, I would like to be helpful to, but I know it's not going to be helpful for me. So what I have done is to create avenues that allow me to still do what I need to do. Now, let me give you an example. You need to treat your time and your energy the same way you treat your money. You are not just going to spread money anyhow because you want to help people and all of that. But at the same time, you should have a budget that, okay, this amount of money is what I want to give to help people every month or every week or every year, depending on how you do it. But let's say every month you have a certain amount of money. So when somebody needs help and it is still within that amount of money, you have not expended it, you can give it. But once that amount of money finishes, you cannot say, hey, because you want to help, and then you are using your child's school fees to help people. That is simply irresponsible. Or you are using your house rent to help people, and then what do you do? So that is irresponsible. It is the same way with your time and energy. You are not being wicked, you are just being wise and responsible. Okay, so what you should do is have a certain amount of time, a certain amount of energy that you have dedicated to that. So for example, now people that want to learn from me, people that want to maybe have coaching sessions and all of that, every Wednesday I have a coaching session now, free, 100% free, and I go deep. I don't say because it's free. In fact, somebody was telling me that, okay, the way you even do these things as if we paid for it, and that is it. So 12:30 p.m. to 2:30 p.m. at least for now, that's every Wednesday, 12:30 p.m. to 2:30 p.m. you can learn anything. If you anything, fine, we have a schedule. Like last month, that's okay for me now. I'm already in August. Okay, I'm recording this July 31, okay, but I'm already in August. So throughout July we talked about website development. That was our main focus. So I taught people how to build websites from the beginning, everything about it, okay, registering your domain name and all of that. This month, August, we're going to be covering digital publishing, but those are the core subjects. We have a core subject for each month, but at the same time, we have time. We have some 30 minutes after the core session when you can ask any question, and I'm going to attend to you and all of that. So I have earmarked that time. I don't do anything else with it. I make sure that I protect that time, okay? So you can come within that time and get whatever you want to get. But after that time, I am not available, okay? I have to face my family, I have to face my business, I have to face my ministry, I have to face other aspects of my life, okay? Do you understand? So that is it. So it's not like you are shutting people off. It's not like you are not interested in helping people, but you have to be responsible about how you do it. The same way you are not going to just spread your money all over because you want to help people, that is the same way you shouldn't just give out your time, your energy, your attention, okay, because you want to help people. It's important to help people, it's important to be useful for others, but you need to audit your activities and commitments in such a way as to do those things responsibly. Okay, we are getting close to the end of this teaching, and what I would like to leave you with is this, that if you find yourself in a hole, stop digging. I think that is attributed to Will Rogers, but I don't know exactly who said it, but I had it and it just made a lot of sense. I had it many years ago. It just occurred to me as I was preparing this, that okay, this is very relevant. If you only remember this, it's going to trigger a lot of positive response, positive actions on your part. If you find yourself in a hole, stop digging. So what is the hole that you have found yourself in? How did you get there? What led you there? Stop doing those things and then start doing the opposite. Okay, stop doing those things that you feel like doing. okay, you are feeling sad, you are feeling bad, and because of that you don't want to see anybody, you just lock up yourself, then you are still digging, you understand? So what you should do is, even though you don't feel like going out, you don't feel like reaching out to others, do it, because that is how to stop digging. Okay, so if you find yourself in a hole, stop digging. That is the final piece of advice that I am going to give you. Yeah, okay, so we're going to meet again next week, and for you to receive updates and other resources, sign up on my website www.philipamiola.org. And if you have questions, submit your questions on anything, any question on life and business, okay, submit it at connect.tpchealth.com.ng/ask. connect.tpchealth. TPCL is short for the Plenipotent Company Limited. connect.tpchealth.com.ng/ask. Ask ASK. Okay, so submit your questions there, and I'll either answer it in one of the episodes of More Brains Less Muscle, or I will get across to you directly and answer that question. Thank you very much for listening. Please share this with your friends and family and others that can benefit from it. And don't forget to join my community at www.philipamiola.org. Enter your name, enter your email and phone number so that we can keep in touch. There's some materials, there's some things and some updates that I only share with people in my community, and you don't want to miss out on those. If at any time you feel like it is not worthwhile for you, you can always unsubscribe. I only want to connect with people that really want to connect with me. So if you don't want to connect with me, it's fine. No problem about that at all. Then let's connect on social media also. Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. My username is @philipamiola for my personal account. I also have a Facebook page, facebook.com/poamiola, but my personal account on Facebook, the username is @philipamiola. The same thing for Twitter and for Instagram. So let's connect on all of those platforms. And you have my email on the screen if you are watching the video, but if you are using the audio, my email is philip@philipamiola.org. And my Philip has just one hell. I know some people spell their own Philip with two hell, and some even had hell, but me, I like to keep things simple. Okay, so you don't have to guess. No. No hairs and only one hell. The simplest Philip ever. Okay, the simplest spelling of Philip that you can get. So Philip Amiola. Amiola is AMIOLA. philip@philipamiola.org. And if you want to call me, it's okay. You want to call or initiate a WhatsApp chat, you have the number on the screen also. 706, that's 0706-090-5134. If you are calling from outside Nigeria, then you add +234 before that. Okay, so that's that. Thank you once again, and bye for now.